First of all, you should see my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Amazing. And now the PPT. Ah. Fantastico, questo ecco. 5 sì, secondi sì. In ritardo, non capisco perché.
Ok, io sono in treno, prende male, prende poco.
People, can you hear me?
Yes.
Ok, perché il computer mi sta dando di matto. Mi rifà sentire le mie parole 10 secondi dopo ed è terribile. Voi mi sentite due volte, ripetuto?
Io no.
Ok.
Io no, adesso sono in treno, quindi non so se andrà bene il tutto.
Ok. Allora, mi metterò semplicemente il computer in muto. È così. Ok, people. So, I share again the screen. Please, the one who has the video, so Elia. Do me a sign like okay if you can see everything and you can hear me. Amazing. Okay, so let's start. Apparently it will not be very interactive because I cannot use the audio too much, but okay, I will start still with some question. First, how many of you have ever heard, received a training about 4DX and 5 dysfunction of a team? And how much do you feel confidence with it? Who wants to start? Dai, raga.
Ok, you can hear me?
Yes.
No. Okay.
Yes, yes. Sì. No, ok, l'audio non mi funziona, non capisco perché. So, I will just start talking and I hope you will enjoy. So, how to manage a team, some simple theories. What we're going to see today are two theories that we use in Isaac to manage teams. And to manage properly, like the main resources we have, because basically people are our main and strongest resource in ISAC. The first one is five dysfunction of a team. Why it is useful? Why do we work with five dysfunction of a team? Because it is a cool way to understand which are the needs of a team and which are the problems that can happen during the life of a team and understand how we can prevent them, basically. So which are the main things that we can do to prevent five dysfunctions to happen. So which are the five dysfunctions? They are this. If you can see, absence of trust, fear of conflict, lack of commitment, avoidance of accountability, and inattention to results. And the interesting thing is why there is this pyramid shape is because each of them, starting from the basis to the top, each of them leads to the following dysfunction. So it is very common that if you have absence of trust inside a team, this will lead, or immediately, or in a bit of time, to having fear of conflict. if you are a fear of conflict, if you don't discuss, if you don't argue with each other, you will have lack of commitment, etc., etc., etc. What we're going to watch today is, for every of them, why those problems are relevant in a team and what we can do about them. So, which is the main thing that we should take care of to avoid that this is an issue for us. Okay, so first of all, absence of trust. Also, how to fight them, let's say. First of all, absence of trust. What happens when in a team there is absence of trust? First of all, people like hesitate to ask for help. If you start having a team in which people don't trust each other, you don't create a mood in which people can help and support each other. So you don't create a mood in which people ask for help. And that creates to not being not being interested in participating in the common activities, because you don't feel that the team is useful for you. If you don't trust each other, you don't think that staying with the team and doing activities with the team is anyhow useful. And so you start avoid the team in general, so communicate with the team, to have a relation with the team, and of course this leads to avoiding being in the meetings or being just present but not really into having a meeting and into understanding the utility of doing the meetings. Why this happens and why teams start not having trust? What the guy that wrote this theory, Patrick Lencioni, the author of this book, says is that trust is not something that you build, first of all, because you know other people are able to work, but most of all, because people knows which are each other's vulnerability and knows that every one of them has something for which they are vulnerable. No one is perfect in the team. And so they are free, they feel free to show their vulnerability and to ask for help when they need. So the first thing that you have, like when you're building a team, and the first thing that you will see, for example, that we will do, for example, before to make you plan, and that you should do inside a team, any kind of team you're leading, anytime you have, is creating this atmosphere in which you can be vulnerable to the team. And then people can be vulnerable to you. Because if the leader starts being vulnerable and understanding that he is not perfect, but he has to show to the others that he has some weaknesses and that they can help them in overcoming his weaknesses, but also that he can help them for their weakness, that starts creating an environment in which people collaborate and work together. They talk to each other, they ask for help, and they have the right environment to work. If you start a team, you have all newbies and you pretend with them to be perfect, they are going to look at you just as someone with which they don't want to mess. They don't want, for example, you to understand that they were not doing something, or that they were not able to do something, and they will start hiding you what they are not doing or what they are doing bad. And this will lead you to not being able to manage your team properly. That's pretty simple. Second thing, what leads absence of trust? It leads teams to have fear of conflicts, because of course, as I was explaining, I don't feel that my team leader is vulnerable. I don't feel like telling him that maybe I'm not doing something or I'm not doing something properly. I don't feel like I can discuss so openly problem. For sure, I'm not going to talk to each other and to point each other their own errors. I'm not going to speak about problems of the team because I don't feel like it's possible to do it. And so what happens when this absence of trust scale and goes to into fear of conflicts is that people are not transparent. They hide themselves. They hide themselves to the team and to the team leader also. And then, so people start going around discussions. You don't start a discussion on the real problem of the team because everyone deep inside knows which is the real problem, but no one wants really to talk about it because they feel the pressure and the scare of having their boss being rude to them or addressing the problem in a bad way. because they think it's perfect or he doesn't want to admit his problem. So they start hiding everything. And when, of course, there is a problem, because it is evident that there is a problem, people start discussing all the little things that can be somehow involved with the problem, but that are not the real problem. And, of course, confusion arises in the team. When all the time, in every meeting you have, you start discussing about problems that are not the core of the problem, but that are side problems, of course, it creates confusion. And of course, it creates the impossibility of working properly in your team. Also here, what to do about it and what to do to avoid fear of conflicts. Ensure that every member can speak up. Like, it's very important. Then even if you are sure that they trust each other, then you do also the step over. Okay, we trust each other. So we know that every one of us can speak, can express his opinion, can say to the others, okay, I think this is wrong, or I think this is right. Because this is the way in which you involve them in the conversation. This is the way in which you make them feel comfortable being part of the team and also taking decision for with the team, but most of all, acting after what you decided in the team. Because that's the problem that then the fear of conflict generates. If people have fear of having conflict, of course, they start lacking of commitment. You don't want to argue with each other. You don't want to express your opinion. Then, of course, the decision that people take start getting ambiguous because you don't talk about your problems. So you take decisions that are not very important, but also because the decision that people take, you don't feel them as relevant because you are not discussing them. If I'm not putting my opinion on the table, if I'm not discussing what I think, of course, then I can even agree on what you tell me to do, but I don't think that is relevant. And why this is very, very dangerous to happen. Because whenever you do something, but you don't really believe in what you're doing, of course, you don't do it well. And of course, whenever it starts happening something maybe wrong, you just wash your hands and say, okay, people, I told you this was the wrong decision, or maybe I not even told you. I never thought this was the good decision. So if something is going wrong, I will not try to correct it. I will just say, okay, I knew this was wrong. What to do about it? What to do when people are lacking of commitment and when people are trying to not taking responsibility of the decision of the team? You have to, first of all, communicate clearly expectations. If you didn't tell from the beginning, guys, this is your responsibility, and I expect you to take commitment of it and not to have excuses, and to be present here, and to understand that if you take this decision, you have to take it, bring it forward. This creates a mess. You have to tell them clearly what we expect from them in each moment of their team life, even before they join the team. So before you recruit, tell people how much they're going to work. Tell people what you're going to expect from them. Before you select people on your team, on whatever, tell them, okay, this will be our job. We will work like this, this, and this. You will have to achieve this, this, and this. If you don't achieve it, I will go and tell you this is not okay. And the second thing, after discussing, take clear decision. If you discuss, you have a team meeting, there is a topic, everyone expresses his opinion, maybe you will not arrive to a decision in which everyone agrees. But you have to be able to say, okay, people, I listened to all your opinion, I understood them, I understand why you're saying this, and I got your point, I understand why you are saying that, and I got your point, but now we have to take a decision, and the decision will be this, this, and this, dot. So whenever you shape a discussion, people argue, but then you gather all the inputs and you take a final decision that is clear, that you can write down and tell everyone what to do, then you onboard people and you commit people because everyone feels you are listening to them. So even if they don't agree, they know that that was the decision taken from by the team collectively, and that is okay to follow it. Next problem that arises if everything starts getting ambiguous and if people start not committing to their to their decision and objectives, it is the avoidance of accountability. Of course, what happens when people avoid to be accountable to each other? They miss key deadlines and deliverables. If I start thinking that every decision we take is wrong, I don't see the point of doing what I should do. Bad performances are tolerated because I don't think that performances are bad because of me, but it's always because of others. So it's fine that things are going wrong because I don't feel the ownership of those bad results. And bad behaviors are not tackled. So if everyone starts being not accountable, everyone starts tolerate also that also the other can be not accountable. So I'm doing something wrong, and I see someone else doing something wrong, I don't call it out. And everyone starts feeling more comfortable in doing wrong things or in missing to do the right things. And everyone is okay with it. What to do about this? How can you call out accountability in a team? Well, it's very simple. You have to call out the bad behaviors every time they happen. If you're a leader and you're a team leader of a team, you cannot think that you can let things go. If someone missed a deadline, you have to call him and tell him, my dear, you missed the deadline. If someone doesn't do a certain thing, you have to tell, hello, you cannot do this thing. If someone is behaving bad with a member of the team, you have to tell him, my dear, you are behaving bad. You cannot behave like this. And of course, this is very stressing because it's very stressing being there present at every deadline. It's very stressing that every team meeting you have to take, you have to understand who is in, and for the people that are not in, call them and tell them, no, my dear, you cannot miss this. You have to be here. It's very stressing, I know, but it's the first step to start generating a good environment, because if you start making rules respected, people will start make rules respected. If you start being very pinny and cool with the rules at the beginning, then other people will start telling each other, okay, but that guy is missing. I will tell him. I will not ask my team leader to call out the bad behavior. If I'm a member of my team, I know that rules are respected, and I see one of the other members of my team not respecting rules, I go there and I tell him, my dear, you cannot do it like this. And they start creating a healthy environment because everyone starts understanding that they have to call out bad behaviors. They have not to accept bad behaviors to happen, and they make the team improve. Last point, inattention to results. What happens when people have fear of conflict, lack of commitment, they are not accountable to each other, they don't give shit of the final results? Ego arises in the team. Because if I'm not accountable, if no one is doing anything, everyone pretends to be the only one doing sacrifices sometimes. Everyone pretends that what is doing is the right thing. Everyone pretends to be the only one relevant in the team. People focus on personal results over team results. Of course, if I don't see the matter of staying together, of being accountable to each other, I don't see the matter of having a common goal. I just strive for mine. And of course, this leads to very bad performances because no one gives shit of the collective performance. What to do about it? And of course, there is a lot of team turnover. If no one gives shit of team performances, if team doesn't achieve result, of course, people go out of the team. Why to stay in such a team where no one is there for each other, where no one is trying to do something for each other? What to do about it? Of course, talk about always common goals. If you talk about common goals, people have, understand that they have to work for that and give a focus to the team, give clarity on which are the basic things that needs to happen. If everyone is clear with which are the things that needs to happen to achieve the goal, then everyone start getting more involved in the results. Okay. Okay, I'm opening the audio. Are you understanding until here? Everything's okay?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. I will go on then. Now, we came on with this thing. We were watching this pyramid. So I was giving you a suggestion on what to do to tackle each of these problems. But you may have noticed that some of the solutions we were bringing were a bit not so clear, or we were missing a bit of small practices that we can have in order to achieve some of those points. And so it's here that I will introduce another theory. And this other theory, that it's of course, for the X, will help us exactly on working on those 3 points. This is another famous book, another book that company uses, that a lot of other association use it to manage their job. And it's a theory that helps team working on those things, having more commitment, being accountable to each other, and then achieve results. So when you work, when we talk about 4DX, and when you will see working about 4DX, what you have to understand is that it's not an Isaac thing, for example. It's not a theory that we invented inside our organization, but it's a methodology, a work methodology that a lot of companies uses to make people achieve their goal. And so to solve those problems, because those are the most common problems that lead teams not to achieve their goal. So, okay. What is this? Exactly what I was saying. This is a theory, a methodology to work, and this is the methodology that we are using for all Isaac in Italy. So if you see the national plan is based on 4DX, and you will see that the frame that we are going to use for your plans will be based on 4DX. So if with 5 dysfunction, you can also admit not to know perfectly the theory of that, but just to get some inputs. With 4 disciplines of execution, it's very, very, very important that you understand why we're using it, and that you understand every single point, because you are going to deal with this for all the next year. And there is no way you will avoid this. What's the main purpose and why 4 disciplines of execution were created from his author? It's because what he noticed is that most of teams in every company of the world don't achieve their results, not because they were having bad strategies, but simply because they were not able to put those strategies in concrete, to execute their strategy, to work day by day and be good enough to bring the strategy on and make them the winning ones. So this is a theory that helps us to focus on which are the most important things that we have to do. So if in your daily job, you see that you have tons of things that you should be doing, and you don't know where to start, you don't know which is the most important, you don't know what will lead you the result, think about 4DX, think about what they are saying, and try to understand that those things, the one that we will point out in the next 10 minutes, are the main, most important ones to achieve your results. That are the one in which you should spend more time working during your week, during your day, etc., etc. So, which are the 4 disciplines of execution? First one. Okay, the graphic was a bit. Focus on the wild important, the week. What is the wild important goal? Is the final goal, the most important goal that we have to achieve inside an organization. For example, in Isaac in Italy, we have this goal that is 3,350 approvals. And that's the goal for which all Isaac Italia should be working for. And it is one. Why it is very important for it to be one? Because that helps to focus our choices. When we don't know what to do, we think, okay, to achieve that, what is the most important thing? But how to set a goal in a way that is easy to achieve and that we can work on it? First of all, it has to be numerical. That should be pretty clear, but you never know. You need to have a number to achieve. Our goal is not developing Isaac, developing more leadership in Isaac Italia. It's delivering 3,350 leadership experiences. Second one, as a start and an end point. So, for example, when you will work in Isaac, you will see that you will have past results. And that's very important, knowing from where you're starting to understand where you want to arrive. So, for example, for Isaac in Italy, it is passing from 2,327 approvals, if I'm not wrong, to 3,350. So which were the results of last year? And which is the result that you want to achieve? To understand which is the gap that we need to fix in order to arrive to the goal. And the last one is a date by which you have to achieve. So for example, you have to achieve pass from, the example here is from 200 to 250 approvals by the 21st January 2018. So you have a time frame. You understand that you cannot achieve your goal whenever you want. You achieve it just if you do it by that date. Second part, and this is the most complicated. So please take a lot of attention, because there are people that I can assure you still after years using 4DX is not very clear. What are lead and lag? What are lead and lag? Basically, they are two kind of measures. So, okay, there are a lot of things that we measure inside an organization. As you may have started to see, we report constantly tons and tons of data. But this, like 4DX theory, tells us that we can classify them in two ways. There are lag measures. And lag measure, what are measures that are really moving our result. So, for example, if you need to do more approvals, of course, we know that the result that we can understand that will lead us closer to have more approvals are sign up, applicants accepted. The more we have sign up, applicant accepted, the closer we get to give more approvals. And of course, approval is another lag measure. So they are the measure of our results. We cannot wake up in the morning and do a sign up. Okay, you can do your sign up on the platform, but you cannot wake up in the morning and do more sign up. And what you can do and wake up in the morning is acting on lead measures. And which are lead measure? The measure that leverage the lag measure. So for example, you wake up in the morning and you go to do a clash out. You can influence the clash out. You can do how many clash out you want. And then you predict that this will lead you to have more result. So more lag measure, more sign up. I do more of this, I achieve more of that. So this is the difference. There are measures that helps you to understand where are you. Lag measure, if I have 50 sign up, 30 applicants, 25 accepted, I understand which is my situation, I understand how much am I closer to my final goal, that is, I don't know, 100 approval. But lead measure are the one that I can work on. Because if I do lot of lead measure, if I do a lot of clash outs, I know that I will have more signups. And this will lead me closer to the goal of approval. But how to choose them? How do you choose your lead and lag? Because what happens usually in Isaac is that we have, of course, our lag measures. Just to work on an Node.js example, those are our main lag measures. And then we have tons of possible lead. And I was just putting some example. I didn't even put all the one that I could. But the clash out, sales points, events, Facebook sharing, online investment, they all need to have more sign up. And then to have more applicants, you can have a higher percentage of contacting in 24 hours. You can do more collimanias, more conversion events, more lead nurturing emails, and a lot of other stuff. Of course, If every week you have to track and report all those measures, you are fucked. You are fucked. You don't understand what's happening. Because if you have 3,000 measures, no one of that is relevant. And how can you understand what you should be doing? It's impossible. So what 4DX tells you is you have to choose which are the important lag for you and which are the important lead for you. You have to focus in some of them. Dot. And so what can you do to understand which of those time thousands of measures you should be working on? For example, you can check your result and you see, for just to do a random example, you have 150 sign up and you have 20 applicants. You have 19 accepted and you have 18 approved. If you see from 20 applicants to 18 approved, the difference is very low. So you don't have that many problems in getting accepted and in getting approved once you have applicants. But you have a very big problem because out of 150 sign up, you have just 20 applicants. Moreover, if you do more sign ups, if you do 500 sign ups, for example, instead of 150, you can move much more the scoreboard. So what you understand looking at those things is that those are your main problems. Those are the things that you should work on more. And with this, you have selected your lag. You cut out the other lags because they are not relevant for you. You know that if you just track those two lags that are the most important for you, you are going to achieve your goal. And second thing, then you have to achieve you to understand which are the most important leads, because still 9 leads are a lot to track. And then you start understanding, okay, which of those things, thresholds, self-balance events, are bringing me more signups? And for example, you may decide that those are thresholds and online investments. The more you do threshold, the more you invest online, the more you get the results. And those are more important than sales points because you get more results from a threshold than from a sales point. Of course, this is an example. You can choose exactly the opposite. But the important thing is that you have to choose which are the ones that for you are relevant. Same thing for the applicant, which are the measures that make me achieve more applicant. And I decided they are contacting in 24 hours and conversion events, because those are the things that are making me really converting signups into the applicant. So what you do, you cut out all the other measures. And you decide that your plan will be looking like this. You have two lags, sign up, an applicant. And you have 4 leads, clash out, online investment, conversion events, contact in 24 hours. What you have to do to achieve your week? Just this. Do more clash out, invest more online, do more conversion events, contact everyone in 24 hours. Can you do also all the other things? Of course. But when you will see that you are not achieving your result, the only way that you will have to achieve your result is doing more of this. It's not losing your mind in thinking which are the thousands and thousands and thousands of things that I can do. There's nothing magic that you can do. If you do more of this, you will achieve. This is planning and working with 4DX. You choose which are the relevant measures for you and you bet everything on those measures. This is very important. Why? Because it keeps your team focused on the goal. If you saw which were the problems that you were pointing out when there was the issue of inattention to result, it was what you should do was exactly talking about the goal and giving a focus to the team. And what we were looking at with 4DX is that we were exactly focusing on goal and giving a clear focus to the team. There are those 4 measures that are fundamental and I have to work on them all the time. Dot. But then, which are the other 2 disciplines of execution? First of all, keep a compelling scoreboard. Because it's not just about what you have to do, but how to keep the whole team engaged to this thing. You know that your most important thing is your goal, and you know that the measure that will lead you to that goal are your are your main important leads. But now, how to keep all the team engaged in pushing more to do those leads? First of all, you have to create a compelling scoreboard. What is a scoreboard? Before to show you this, it is simply a visualization of your results. a graphical visualization of your results. Why it is important? For the same reason why you have, for example, a scoreboard when you watch any sport match, because that shows you instantly if you're winning or if you're losing. And that should show you instantly, like, which is the status of your job. If you see that you're winning or that you're losing, you are pushed to win. And that's the basic concept. If you know that you are not winning, then you want to win. If you people, you don't remind your members all the time which is your current status, how much you're achieving, of course, they will not give a shit of achieving your results. That's simple. So, how to create a scoreboard is compelling. That means that is engaging them, that they will like to see, that they want to see all the time. First of all, it has to be everywhere. You have to show them the scoreboard, otherwise they don't get interested into the result. And those are very small examples. You can put it in your WhatsApp groups, as we all the time. You can put it in your tracking tools. You can put it in the PPTs that you use for your EP meeting all the time. Those are basic things. Every time you can put a scoreboard, put it, because that helps people focusing on their results. It's fundamental. Then, second thing, it has to push people to win the game. It has to be cool. Because if it's a cool scoreboard, I want to win more. For example, why people, if I have to check the result, prefer to go on Core? Most of people, at least, the one that knows Core, usually, when they have to watch the results, doesn't go to Expa, but they go to Core. Core is this Egyptian platform in which you can see the result of every LC and of every entity in the world. That's very simple, because Core has this amazing feature that is called rankings. Core is all based on rankings. So what's amazing of Core? That you go there and you see who you are over or under the test. You are over or under the entity. And that's engaging. Like, I want to see if I'm winning, if I'm overpassing the test, if I'm not doing it, etc., etc. Well, even if on Expa, I have more information, because Expa has much more information, still, people go on Core, because that's compelling. That shows me if I'm winning. And so I like it. And this is the concept. You have to create a scoreboard that makes people willing to win. Just this. And the third part, it has to show lag and lead. Because if you decide that those measures are fundamental for you, you have also to see every day that those measures are leading you to have more results. You have to show, for example, that if you do more threshold, you have more signups. That if you do more collimanias, you have more applicants. If you don't see it every day, if you don't see the relation of between what you are doing and which are your results, then you start not doing what you should be doing anymore, because you don't think that those leads are very relevant, but they are the only relevant thing for you, for your day-by-day work at least. And last point, to keep your team engaged with this whole thing, is to create a cadence of accountability. What does it mean? Sorry, there is a mistake that I should have corrected, but okay. How to create a cadence of accountability? It's very simple. You have to review every week your results in a certain way. So you must have weekly meetings. If you don't have weekly meetings, of course, people get disengaged from their goal, because they never talk about it. They never have the possibility to review what they are doing and to understand how to go forward. If you don't do weekly meetings, don't expect anyone to be anyhow willing to achieve your goal or to be engaged with the association. There's no possibility. But then, how to do weekly meeting? Follow the structure, account review plan structure. How does it work? This is the basic way that you should act on to do a proper meeting. So first of all, very simple. At the beginning of your meeting, everyone should say what he has done and what he has not done of his deliverables. Last week, I should be doing this, this, and this. I did the first, I did the second, I didn't do the last. And it's not the team leader saying this, it should be the member reporting what he did or not did. Because in that case, everyone feels more responsible. If I'm pointing the finger to you, it's very different if I have to admit that I didn't do something. I feel much more guilty, first step. And then I feel more responsible of what was my responsibility. And that everyone can see in my team that I was not fulfilling my responsibility. The second thing is checking collectively the results achieved. So we did this, we didn't do this. And the consequences of what we do was this result. And this is very important because you see the, again, you see the consequence between what you are doing and what you are achieving. After seeing the result, you can understand what was wrong and what was right. And you start planning. What are we going to do next week? This, this, and this action. And you have to write them down. Write them down possibly in a tool, in a decent tool where you can check them every time. Because then at the next meeting, you will check again. This was done, this was not done. This brings a lot of clarity on what should be done. And this brings to everyone the commitment of making those things done in the next week. This is very simple, I think. And just to recap, why it is very important to have a cadence of accountability, because this influences exactly the other two problems that we were talking about, watching the five dysfunctions of a team. You call out the bad behaviors because everyone has to show that he was having good or bad behavior during a team. And you create commitment because you you take clear decision, you take you every time you have clear deliverables so everyone knows what to do. And there are clear expectations of what you should be achieving. So if you start having those things, you solve, or better, you anticipate the problem of not having a committed team and not having an accountable team, because this helps you to keep your team engaged and accountable all the time. So just to recap, some tips on which are the most important things that you should do with your team to have a cool environment and to have a team that wants to work and wants to achieve results and work collectively to achieve this result. First of all, be vulnerable, open with your with each other and start sharing which are your strengths, but also your weaknesses, so you create the right environment. Second thing, make people free to discuss. If they are not able to discuss and to give their opinions, they will never be engaged in your goal. Set clear expectation and take clear decision. The more you are clear on what you expect from people, the more you can expect people doing that thing. If you lie, if you try to tell them, "Mom, but this is not very heavy, but you can do it, this, and this," you will set low standard and people will never do. Will always, always try to do less than what they should be doing and they will quit. Call out bad behaviors. Don't leave bad behaviors to stay there and to happen. Every time something proper is not happening, you have to take your phone. It's very stressing, but it's very short. Take your phone, call, and tell, "My dear, you cannot. It's not because I'm a motherfucker. It's just because I want to tell you that this is not proper for you, for the team, and for and for the association." In attention of result, focus on the goal. Talk all the time about the goal. Make them visualize the goal. And again, which are the main things that you should do to work on 4DX? Choose a timely and numerical goal that is very clear for everyone. Act on the key measure that you can influence, lead measure, because those are the ones that you can do every day. You wake up in the morning and you act on your lead measure, so you know you will achieve. Create a scoreboard that people will look at, a scoreboard that everyone wants to see every day to see if they're winning. And finally, review every time, every week, your measure and the action to take. Review all the time what they're doing, discuss about them, take decision, and make everyone involved in doing something for the well-being of the team. So, from my side, this was everything. Now, I will leave you the space for having some questions, but before I will stop the broadcast for the simple reason that otherwise I have this echo going on.